Ladies and gentlemen, please find your seat, remove your caps, and rise for our national anthem, performed live by recording artist Jessica Lizette.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Jessica Lizette, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Downtown Las Vegas Event Center, live from the world-famous Downtown Las Vegas. This is Barry Myers, Tuff-N-Uff, Holdsworth, Couture, and Rousey. Tonight, in the cage and on the stage that Barry built, you will see the future stars of MMA. Fight fans, are you ready for a war? The cage is now open for business. Let's get to work. Now making their way to the blue corner, Taquan Meeks.
Beautiful night here in downtown Las Vegas at the Downtown Las Vegas Event Center. We got ourselves Taquan Meeks and Devontae Burnham about to set our night off. Very, very excited to be with you guys tonight. I'm Dave Farrell alongside Jason Mahoney. And we got ourselves a 20-year-old man here who is making his debut. Excuse me, he's got one fight on his record against somebody who is making his debut. And he's got himself, perhaps, Mahoney, one of the finest nicknames that I've ever heard in all of combat sports. He is Taquan Shoddy the Pimp Meeks.
That is quite the nickname. A lot to live up to, I would say. But looking forward to seeing Taquan Shoddy the Pimp Meeks fight here tonight at Tuff-N-Uff.
Yeah, going to get us going this evening, fighting at 125 pounds, so we expect that fast action. He's 0-1, got into mixed martial arts 3 years ago, training four times a day, so he is taking this seriously. Doesn't know anything about his opponent, says he doesn't even care. In 5 years from now, though, he sees himself as the 125-pound champ in the UFC. Works in retail outside of this, but fighting is his passion again. Four times a day he is training. This could be a big moment for him tonight. Here he goes, making his way into the Tuff-N-Uff cage at the Downtown Las Vegas Event Center.
And now making his way to the red corner, Devontae Burnham.
Now, Devontae Burnham, obviously also 125 pounds, also 20 years old. He is making his debut tonight. Now, I just said that Shoddy the Pimp had one of the best names that I'd ever heard in mixed martial arts. This may be the battle of the nicknames, Mahoney.
What do we got here tonight,
Dave? Devontae Burnham is the suplex submission machine.
A lot to live up to. He's training out of Danger Den here in Las Vegas. I don't know if I've ever seen, in all my years of watching mixed martial arts, seen a submission pulled out of a suplex.
By a suplex. No, I don't think so. But, I mean, apparently he's a machine at that, so we will see. He trains every day, and he says he trains for 4 hours every day as well. So you've got two guys that are laying it all out on the table, saying that they train for hours a day. Both of them see themselves as future UFC champions. So this could be a really exciting fight tonight. Like I said, at 125 pounds, we expect these fights to move fast.
And that's a division that the UFC is always looking to fill. Both these guys look to be in impeccable shape. I mean, with Taquan saying that he trains four times a day and Devontae saying that he trains 4 hours a day, both of these guys look to be in incredible shape. I expect this fight to be explosive, Dave.
Yeah, and you mentioned that, you know, the UFC is always looking for fighters at 125 pounds. Last time we did one of these events, Sean Shelby showed up, Dana White showed up, Randy Couture showed up. You never know who's going to be in the audience. So, again, could be a big moment for these young fighters, just 20 years old, promising futures. Let's see who comes out on top.
Ladies and gentlemen, our first bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds in the Tuff-N-Uff flyweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner with a record of no wins and one loss, fighting out of Ninth Isle BJJ, Las Vegas, Nevada, Taquan Shoddy the Pimp Meeks. His opponent stands across the cage in the red corner, making his Tuff-N-Uff debut tonight, fighting out of Danger Den, Las Vegas, Nevada, Devontae Burnham. Your referee in charge of the action inside the cage is Mark Chappie Smith.
Mark Smith, one of the best referees in mixed martial arts. Always great to have him in the cage officiating the action. We've got 3 2-minute rounds. That is our format for tonight, with the exception of the main event. We'll get to that later. Right now, our first fight of the evening, we are set to go. Meeks is wearing the green trunks with the yellow and the red. Burnham is wearing the black and the green, and quickly they clash in the center of the cage. Oh, big slam there for Meeks. He ends up inside control.
Nice flurry that led to that takedown.
Yeah, not a lot of feeling out.
Not at all.
And you know, when you train for 4 hours a day, and that's something that both of these fighters have said, they're training for multiple times and multiple hours a day. Sometimes you're like, you know what? This is my moment. This is the fun part. I'm just going to go for it. But as you see, well, there's a nice reversal there. Burnham ends up in top position, close guard of Meeks. But Meeks has been the one that's been the more effectively aggressive one early on in this first round.
We saw Burnham try to go for a suplex there, but ran into the cage and was reversed by Meeks, but ended up on the bottom, but reversed it very nicely. And now we see him on top working against Meeks.
Just about a minute left here in the first round. Lots of action so far. Got a sneaking feeling that if Burnham can end this round strong, he could steal it away here.
Both these guys working very hard up against the cage.
Going for that hip toss. Meek's doing a nice job of being heavy.
We're seeing some nice nice suplex and toss defense there from Meeks, Dave.
He's still going for it, and Meeks reverses it, ends up on top, kind of has the back there. Burnham's trying to hold on.
And you got to remember, there are no elbows to the head in amateur MMA.
Final 10 seconds here of round number one. Daquan Meeks has done a nice job in this round. Like I said, he has been effectively aggressive, and that is how round number one is going to come to a close.
Good round for Meeks there, Dave. I think he did a good job reversing, but we also saw a pretty good showing from Burnham. If I had to guess, I would think Meeks with the reversals and the more time spent in top position is going to get that round from the judges.
Yeah, and Meeks had all of the takedowns. Burnham did end up reversing that one, and he ended up in top position, but Meeks was effective in getting every single takedown in that first round.
Yep.
So definitely leaning his favor there for round number one. We'll see if Burnham is going to try to slow down the pace a little bit, because he came out guns a-blazing, and he does have a height and reach advantage, but he didn't really put that to use. And when they got in tight, Meeks did a nice job of being the shorter, more compact fighter and staying heavy, and also utilizing his ability to elevate Burnham there, as you saw, and slam him down.
We saw a lot of power there for Meeks, you know. It's
got underneath him, yeah.
Absolutely. That takes a lot of energy, but I have a feeling that there's not going to be a lot of feeling out again. I think both these fighters are in excellent shape. Both these guys are going to throw it all out here in the second round because they know what's on the line, fighting in the premier amateur MMA organization that is Tuff-N-Uff.
2 more minutes on the clock. Here we go with round number two, downtown Las Vegas Event Center. It is Daquan Meeks and Devontae Burnham.
Burnham circling away from Meeks' power. Nice back fist, spinning back fist there, though. Ooh, clipped him.
Yeah, and Burnham goes down. Meeks ends up in top position here. Once again, has side control. He's got plenty of time to work here, and he is working fast on the ground.
That was a short little clip that actually put Burnham down.
He's looking for a submission here. He's got that arm locked up. It's almost as if it's a reverse crucifix. Now he's going for the arm, but he's in a really strange position right now. It's going to be hard to complete from there. He is correcting it. Still working. Now he's got that arm extended.
Cranking.
He's cranking. Burnham's doing everything
he
can to.
No,
that's
no.
It. That is the end, ladies and gentlemen. Daquan Meeks, round number two, puts it away, evens up his record to 1-1, and all of that training has paid off.
Saw the submission, kept going for it, did not let up, and comes away with the victory tonight. A lot of heart shown by Daquan, shorty to pimp Meeks, evening up his record to 1-1 here in the Tuff-N-Uff Fighting Championships.
Love seeing these young guys compete, especially when it is an important moment for them in their young careers. Again, Daquan Meeks came into this at 0-1 and really wanted to make a statement tonight. He did that. He remained composed throughout the entire fight. He looked good. He never looked overwhelmed. He was going up against a fighter who was taller than him, did have a reach advantage, was not afraid to exchange with him. You see a nice show of sportsmanship there between the two fighters. but he utilized everything in his power. He stayed low when he needed to. He spun out. He pivoted when he was in a striking battle with Devontae. So really nice job there by Daquan Meeks.
Showed quite a bit of power, too. He did drop him with just a short little shot there as well. So, I mean, I would say on all aspects of his game, Daquan shorted to Pimp Meeks for only having two fights. Looked fantastic tonight.
Here's our official announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 54 seconds into the second round, referee Mark Smith calls a stop to the fight for your winner by tap out due to arm lock, Daquan shouted a pin, Meeks.
We always talk about the future stars of MMA, and that's what Barry Meyer's world famous Tuff-N-Uff is all about. We have got 8 more fights to go tonight. We have a lot of lighter weight fighters. We've got a couple of ladies coming up next. At 140 pounds, this is Tuff-N-Uff from the downtown Las Vegas Event Center. We'll be right back.
In a rec, need a check.
In a rec, need a check.
In a rec,
in a rec,
need a check.
Hurt in a rec, and need a check. I'm attorney Glenn Lerner. One call, that's all.
Glenn Lerner is the way to go. Call 877-1500.
You could be larger than life.
First Impression, Henderson and Las Vegas' number one source for signs and printing. Family owned and operated for over 15 years, specializing in banners, signs, and graphics. Two locations to better serve you, call us at 220-7446 or online at afivegas.com. That's 220-7446 or online at afivegas.com.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to bring out the Tuff-N-Uff women's division. Making their way to the blue corner, Kiara Ramos.
Kiara Ramos at 24 years old is making her debut tonight. It's great to be with you at the downtown Las Vegas Event Center. And Kiara Ramos again, 5'6", 24 years old, tipping the scales at 140 pounds, going up against another young lady, Desiree Jackson, who's also making her debut tonight, just 19 years old, fighting out of the beautiful state of Utah, the St. George area, Mahoney. So
beautiful area.
Kiara Ramos is the first one up tonight, and she is a striker. Trains with the Guild and, again, making her debut. She's been getting ready for this for a while now, so she got into mixed martial arts a couple of years ago, took about a year off, and total of 7 months full of mixed martial arts training. So not a whole lot of time under the belt, but at the same time, we've seen some of these fighters that come in at a younger age, and again, she's just 24 years old, who are very quick at picking up mixed martial arts, and they're training with people who are some of the best in the business now. So whether or not she's going to come in her debut and look like an experienced veteran fighter, we have yet to find that out, but I'm excited to watch her go tonight.
And one of my favorite things about the Tuff-N-Uff Fighting Championships is when we get to see two fighters who have never stepped into the cage at all. So we've got two fighters tonight making their debut here in Las Vegas at one of the premier amateur mixed martial arts championships in the world. We see top of the line fighters here all the time, so who knows what we're going to see tonight, but it's going to be exciting, Dave.
And she is a supervisor in a K-12 school, so you know that she's
tough. And now
tough.
Making her way to the red corner, Desiree Jackson.
Desiree Jackson, fighting out of St. George, originally from Cedar City, Utah. Just up the road here from Las Vegas by a couple of hours. She is 5'6", just 19 years old, Mahoney.
Okay.
140 pounds as well. She loves to do circuit training. She loves to shark tank. Only been fighting in mixed martial arts for 6 months, though. So, again, like you said, two young ladies that are making their debut, still relatively new in the game. Wants to see herself as a pro fighter in 5 years from now, other than mixed martial arts. For work, she is a daycare teacher. So can you imagine You're day kid. Don't you get a lot out of line, kids.
Well, I could imagine that there's maybe a lot of pent-up aggression that could come from that job.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes, you know, you got to be very gentle, very calm, very patient inside the cage. You don't necessarily have to be any of those things.
My significant other works in education. I can tell you there's a lot of pent-up aggression, Dave.
Doesn't know anything about her opponent, but she says that she is ready to go tonight. And again, you know, here in the southwest part of the country, Utah and Nevada and obviously Arizona and California, there's a lot of great schools and a lot of great coaches that are training up some of the best in the business. This is a big showcase moment for Desiree the Animal Jackson out of St. George, Utah. And we are set to go with our first ladies bout of the evening here at Tuff-N-Uff.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds in the Tuff-N-Uff women's 140-pound weight class. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, making her Tuff-N-Uff debut tonight, fighting out of the Guild Rosemead, California, Kiara Ramos. Her opponent stands across the cage in the red corner, also making her Tuff-N-Uff debut tonight. Fighting out of Ace MMA, St. George, Utah, Desiree the Animal Jackson. Your referee in charge of the action inside the cage is the Joe Sullivan.
Three two-minute rounds. Ramos is wearing the black and the white. Jackson is wearing the black and the yellow. Jackson took a shot to the body there. Ramos has her hurt, has her pushed up against the cage. Thought that may be the end for a moment. You see her wincing in pain. Definitely took a shot right to the midsection. Looks like it knocked the wind out of her a little bit. Ramos is trying to capitalize. That's the end. Round number one, 25 seconds in, and Kiara Ramos puts away Desiree Jackson.
Big hands there on Ramos. She showed some really good striking in that 25 seconds that we saw right there. Obviously some big power. And like I said, Dave, two fighters making their debut tonight. We knew it was going to be exciting. 25 seconds, and we saw Ramos walk away with her first victory.
So she's going to the head here, but the shot that really got her was the shot to the body. So, okay, that was the end of the fight. That wasn't the initial one that set it up. But right now, Desiree Jackson is still crumpled over in pain right in front of us. She's being helped up by the referee right now, being put on a stool, still in a significant amount of pain. Her nose is bloodied, but the shot to the body really took it out of her early, mommy.
Almost every fist that was thrown by Ramos landed.
Yeah, deliberate with her striking.
And absolutely.
Again, for somebody that was making her debut tonight, very articulate with her punches and very deliberate with the way that they landed. Very effective striking. Nice job by her dispatching her opponent in just 25 seconds. That's the sort of performance where you go, man, this is easy. I want to do this again next weekend. Let's go.
Next weekend? Why not tonight?
Yeah, put it back into the circuit, man.
Like the old Pride days.
Yeah. So Kiara Ramos, at 24 years old, making her debut tonight, does so in very impressive fashion. Now, again, Jackson is right in front of us. She's on the stool right now. She's being checked out by the doctors. They're taking a close look at her. It looks like she was definitely hurt by that shot to the body. Again, the nose is bloodied a little bit, but she does appear to be okay. They're asking her how she feels, if she's all right. She's nodding. She's getting up on her own power right now and is being let off. So she looks good.
And great stoppage there by Joe Sullivan. You know, fighter safety is paramount here at the Tuff-N-Uff Fighting Championships. That was a good stoppage. As he saw that the fighter was in trouble, he came to a stop immediately.
Here's the official announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 44 seconds into the first round, referee Joe Sullivan calls a stop to the fight for your winner by TKO stoppage, Kiara Ramos.
Kiara Ramos in her debut took her less than 25 seconds to take her opponent out. Beautiful job by Kiara Ramos. Looking forward to seeing more of her. Certainly a future star of MMA. Coming up next, we're going to the 155-pound division, the lightweight, Sir Mosley, Chris Rios. Coming up next, this is Tuff-N-Uff in Las Vegas.
Looking for a more convenient checking account? One that offers all the free services you expect? It's available. One checking rewards from One Nevada Credit Union. You get everything you want from a bank without going to a bank. like 46,000 no-fee ATMs worldwide, over 500 in Nevada, free mobile check deposits and digital coupons, unlimited cash back on debit card purchases, and highly rated local service when you need it. Open a One Checking Rewards account today and discover why more Nevadans are choosing One Nevada Credit Union.
At Sport Clips, we are constantly looking for ways to bring the game to you. That includes our relaxing shampoo.
Are you ready for your rinse?
Maybe we should leave it like it is.
The Sport Clips MVP experience. Great haircut, relaxing shampoo, and legendary hot steam towel. Sport Clips, it's good to be a guy.
This is the original light beer. Brewed to be everything you want in a beer and less. Miller Lite. Hold true.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's bring out our next fight of the evening, making his way to the blue corner, Sir Mosley.
Taking a look at the tail of the tape, Sir Mosley versus Chris Rios. 2-4 for Sir Mosley, 3-7 for Chris Rios. 26 and 24 years old, respectively. Sir Mosley is no stranger to competition, Mahoney. In fact, we were fortunate enough to call a fight just a few weeks ago here at the downtown Las Vegas Event Center in beautiful downtown Las Vegas, and Sir Mosley competed on that card. So he fought just a couple of weeks ago on March the 10th. Had a loss there, put up a competitive fight, but wanted to get right back into it. He classifies himself as a striker, so does his opponent. His challenge last time is that his opponent was more of a grappler. He never really had an opportunity to get his hands going.
Yep.
He's going up against a fellow striker tonight, so it'll be interesting to see how Sir Mosley fares.
And one of the good things about fighting just a few weeks ago, you know, he's still in shape.
Yep.
Not enough time to get fat, unless you're me.
Yeah, put on a couple of pounds since March the 10th.
Just a few.
He is at 5'11", he is a tall 155-pounder, does have a 74.5-inch reach. So 26-year-old Sir Mosley making his way inside of the cage right now. You see Steve Pellegrino there, who is cornering him, one of the best in the business. So excited to see him back in action here at Tuff-N-Uff.
And now making his way to the red corner, Chris Rios.
Chris Rios comes screaming out of the tunnel. He is 26 years old. Nickname is Wartime. 5'7" at 155 pounds. Hometown is Los Angeles. Lives here in Las Vegas and trains with Vandalay Silva's team, Juan Fight Team. 4-6 is the record that he has listed. Here's something interesting, though. We were talking about how Sir Mosley fought just a couple of weeks ago back on March 10th. His last fight was back in August of 2014.
Oh, wow.
It's been a long time since he stepped into the cage. He lost that fight by a split decision to Anthony Taylor. So he said that it's going to be a long, it's been a long time since he's competed. However, he's been thinking about training, and he has been training and putting in the work every single day. So we expect to see the best that Chris Rios has to offer tonight.
I like seeing this just the position of two different fighters, one who's coming off almost a three-year layoff and a guy who's coming off a three-week layoff.
It will be interesting to see these guys mix it up. And again, both of them classify themselves as strikers. Always a lot of fun to watch two guys go toe-to-toe, and that's what we are expecting tonight here in this Tuff-N-Uff fight. And especially, you know, in the amateur ranks with these Tuff-N-Uff fights being shorter rounds, difficult to complete a submission, even if you're one of the best in the world.
Absolutely.
With just 2 minutes on the clock. However, 2 minutes of striking can seem like an eternity. So let's see what happens tonight. Chris Rios, Sir Mosley, we are set to go. Here is Justin Bernard with the official announcements.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds in the Tuff-N-Uff lightweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner with a record of 2 wins and 4 losses, fighting out of Torres MMA, Las Vegas, Nevada, Sir Mosley. His opponent stands across the cage in the red corner with a record of 3 wins and 7 losses. Fighting out of Juan Fight Team, Las Vegas, Nevada, here is Chris Rios. Your referee in charge of the action inside the cage is Mark Smith.
Again, one of the best of the business, Mark Smith calling this fight. reffing this fight. Excuse me.
We're calling this fight.
All right, sir.
He may be calling this fight if I keep messing up.
First round. Fight's on.
3 2-minute rounds. Sir Mosley shakes off the touch of the glove, says, let's get right down to business, and he pushes forward. Rios backs up, stays out of the way of that. Rios is wearing the brown and the red, and then Mosley is wearing the black with the red and the white. Rios with a nice right hand. Mosley pushing forward.
Nice little uppercut there by Mosley.
Yeah, Mosley aggressive early on and kind of to be expected. As I said, was pretty frustrated in his last fight dealing with the grappler.
It's interesting you're seeing these kicks coming from Rios. He's kicking that lead leg of Mosley that Mosley keeps telling him to bring it on, but you can see that knee on Mosley has a wrap on it.
Yeah, and he keeps saying it doesn't hurt, and after all of these years of calling mixed martial arts Mahoney, one thing that we've learned is that normally, not always, but normally when a fighter says that doesn't hurt, or that didn't hurt, it hurt. Rios looking to pick a leg, throws a knee instead. It'll be interesting to see how this exchange goes. Just over a minute left in round number one. Rios has Mosley pushed up against the cage.
Exchanging knees. That one may have gotten a little low. Honestly,
right there.
I don't know how low it was, though. I mean, we had a pretty close view of it. We'll have to see the replay. I mean, it may have grazed.
Yeah, it's always tough to tell when it's that close of quarters exactly where all of the leg is landing, because the knee certainly looked like he was throwing it to the midsection where he intended it to land, but you never know what's going on with the shin and the foot and everything else. So.
That was a very strong knee, but he's getting warned right now by Mark Smith.
Keep him clean on the outside or above the waistline, all right? No retaliation.
Rios trying to shake it off.
No retaliation, all right? Fight fair. Time in. Fight.
And you hear Mark Smith reminding him, do not answer that back. Outside leg kick there from Rios. That's been successful for him so far. Now Rios is saying, yeah, let's go. Let's start throwing some kicks. Keep in mind, Rios listed himself as a Muay Thai fighter, and those are solid kicks he's landing. Gets the takedown, ends up in top position. Mosley trying to scramble out of it. Rios doing a nice job of staying heavy. Remains in half guard.
That was a great single.
Really was. Did a nice job setting it up with powerful kicks. Rush forward. Like you said, picked a leg. Got his opponent down. And while there was some scrambling early on, ended up maintaining that top position. Final 10 seconds here of round number one. Chris Rios is going to end this first round with an exclamation point.
Yep.
And he does.
I think there may have been a little bit of question before that, but I think that left no question in the judges' eyes for who won that first round, Dave. I think Rios definitely took it.
Yeah, and I mean, anyone that trains with, you know, Vanderlei Silva's fight team and Juan fight team, they train really hard at Juan fight team. And you see that come out in the fights. You know, these guys don't come out timid. However, what I did like about Chris Rios' approach is that he didn't rush into it. So Sir Mosley came out just guns a-blazing, and there was the knee right there that came into question. From that angle, it did look like some of his shin maybe did catch down low. However, most of the knee, as we guessed, did go to the body.
Yeah. And as we know, the ones that just graze hurt the worst.
Yeah, sure do. So, as I was saying, Chris Rios did a nice job of being patient and setting up what he wanted to, using those kicks effectively. And you see there, scoop that leg, did a nice job with the trip, ended up in top position on our unofficial scorecards. Chris Rios with one round and none. 2 more minutes on the clock, round number two. Cage doors closing here at the downtown Las Vegas Event Center, and we are back on.
Round. Fight's on.
Rios coming out with a flying kick on that one. Mosley with a nice counter. He clipped him on that one, too. Rios elevates. Big slam. Nicely done. Mosley with a nice reversal. Almost back to his feet.
Wow.
Now he's mounted. There's a lot of time left, especially in the amateur ranks. 1 minute and 30 seconds left here in round number two, and Mosley is trying to get those hips pushed up.
Oh
man, that was a...
Sir, you got to fight back. Let go of the cage. Do not grab the cage.
That was a direct shot to the forehead.
That hurts both people.
And Mosley doing a nice job there, trying to stay busy. You see Rios trying to get the figure four body lock.
Rios is all over him.
Does have it. Got about a minute left here in round number two. He's got the figure four, which really constricts the breathing of your opponent. It's very difficult. Mosley is trying to do everything in his power to spin out of it. He does. Man, that was a terrible position he was in.
Not grab the cage again.
He had given up his back, had the figure four set in on him, and yet somehow gets out of it and ends up being the aggressor here. That shot landed as well, and that one spills Mosley back. Rios once again on top.
Yeah, Rios got him right as Mosley was on both of his knees and clipped him right across the forehead. A lot of fighting both of these guys tonight. Hell of a fight. Hell of a fight so far.
Let's go, Chris. Advance your position. Work. I'm going to stand you up.
You hear Mark Smith telling him you can't just sit there on top, and he does, in fact, advance his position. Moves to full mount. Mosley once again trying to push those hips up and reverse. Ineffective, and Rios again going to end a round with an exclamation point. Nicely done.
I like how referee Mark Smith does not let the downtime just tick away while they're in a non-advantageous position like full guard. You know, he told Rios to advance, and if he did not, he was going to stand up. And as he told him that, Rios advanced. As we look here at the replay, I mean, this was a great takedown by Rios.
I mean, he just muscled him up over his head and slammed him down. Mosley did a nice job. He was staying busy on the ground, but it just appears that Rios, even though he lists himself as a Muay Thai striker, and we've seen those powerful kicks, when it comes to being proficient on the ground, Rios certainly appears to have an advantage there.
And we saw Rios grab the cage there. He's been warned twice. If he grabs that cage again, Mark Smith will take away a point. But at this point, we have Rios up 2-0. Probably won't matter unless he loses this round.
Mosley is going to need a finish, barring something like a point deduction, in round number three, according to our unofficial scorecard. So here we go. We are on to round number three.
All right, guys, third round. Fight's on.
Tough Enough live from the downtown Las Vegas Event Center. Dave Fair, Jason Mahoney, great to be with you tonight.
Mosley slowing down a little bit.
Let's go. Calling both of y'all, stand here and Rios. Let's fight. Stop all the talking and fight.
Mosley lands a couple of shots there. Mosley almost got tripped there. Rios unable to finish it though, and he's got Mosley pushed up against the cage. And you hear the corner of Mosley just imploring him, you've got to knock him down, you've got to hit him. And he's right, but Rios knows that he's up on the scorecard, so wisely ducks down, elevates Mosley, and gets the takedown once again.
We've seen Mosley here all night long. He has a pretty solid advantage from the ground. You know, he's been able to get those takedowns almost with ease in every single round.
Let's go, Chris. Work, advance your position.
And again, Mark Smith, even though he's in top position and he's throwing punches, he's saying, look, advance your position, pushing the action. And that's vital, especially in these two-minute rounds. Not just for the spectators, but also for the fighters. You know, they've got to do something in a very, very short window here if they're going to walk away with a victory. And Steve Pellegrino is imploring Mosley to try to figure out a way to get back to his feet. Went for a submission there. Rios quickly detected it.
Let's go. Fight!
Final 15 seconds of this fight. Mosley shooting in. He's got to get a finish here. Rios says, no, sir, I'll just take you down again. Final 10 seconds of the third and final round. Rios with the back, once again, raining down punches. He's got that neck. He's got the arm underneath.
It's
Can
in.
He secure it?
It's in. Oh,
that is the end, ladies and gentlemen. I think the bell saved him, though, right?
I think he was saved by the bell.
Either way, 3-0 on our unofficial scorecards. Great fight between these two. Sir Mosley putting in a lot of effort, but Chris Rios just overwhelmed him no matter where the fight went.
Shocked to see, you know, how little ring rust that Rios had. Looked like he could have fought 3 weeks ago.
This is the very end of the fight. Let's see, was there a tap here?
No, I don't think
there wasn't a tap. No. So the fight was coming to an end, and it looked like it was possible that he got the finish there because he had that arm underneath the chin, was really going, trying to complete the rear naked choke. Unnecessary, though, is in the final 10 seconds of the fight that he actually got that position, and there you have it. Chris Rios walking away with the victory tonight. Here it is. Big slam. Takes him down again. This was kind of the story of the fight. When they were exchanging back and forth on their feet, Chris Rios doing a nice job with his punches and his kicks, but doing a nice job also elevating, slamming, and getting those finishes. Here we go. Official announcement from Justin Bernard.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we have your winner by unanimous decision, Chris Rios.
He finished the way every round should be finished, with an exclamation point in rounds one, two, and three, leaving no doubt in the judges' minds.
That's how you do it, man. The future stars of MMA, Chris Rios, nicknamed Wartime, put on a show tonight. It's been a long time, years since he was in the cage, and tonight he came out and put on a show. What we love to see from the future stars of MMA. 135-pounders, they're coming up next. This is Tuff-N-Uff Live from the downtown Las Vegas Event Center. We'll be right back.
Arrested? Hi, I'm Amanda Doyle, owner of Blondie Spell Bonds. Call us anytime, day or night. Blondie Spell Bonds offers fast and friendly service and easy payment plans. So if you find yourself here, Blondie Spell Bonds can make it disappear.
Give us a call at 702-388-9100.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's bring out the Tuff-N-Uff Bantamweights, making his way to the blue corner, Calvin Agabin.
Man, you talk about the future stars of MMA and somebody who just fought for us a couple of weeks ago. Calvin Agabin is an 18-year-old who impressed last time out. He was making his debut, so he was 0-0, but he came out and smoked his opponent. His jiu-jitsu is sick. Now, maybe it was just because he had a great matchup. Didn't look like that to me. Like, it looked like he knew what he was doing no matter where the fight went. He was ready for it. Calvin Agabin, I am thrilled that he is back fighting for Tuff-N-Uff tonight. Again, very quick turnaround, but he looked fantastic. He took no damage in his last fight, so great to see him out once again. Nickname is Clark Kent. You saw him take off the glasses. Now I guess he's officially Superman once again. So calm, cool, and collected, Mahoney. That's one thing that really stood out to me, not just in, you know, his presentation here as he's getting Vaseline put on his face, but in his actual fighting style. Like, didn't seem overwhelmed, and for somebody that was making his debut as an amateur, it was stunning to see somebody with that much composure.
Easily could have been his 10th fight. I'm very, very excited to see him fighting here again in the Tuff-N-Uff Fighting Championships. He's fighting a guy who is making his debut as well. Should be interesting to see how Calvin Agabin does tonight. Curious if we're going to see another quick submission.
Yeah, if we do, man, this kid is certainly on to something. He looked like an absolute rock star last time out. But let's meet his opponent who wants to upset that party. Nate Holbrook.
And now making his way to the red corner, Nathan Holbrook.
Now, Nathan Holbrook also lists himself as a jiu-jitsu fighter. He is making his debut tonight, and we saw him on camera a little bit earlier, throwing a spinning back kick at the camera. You know, like, he's ready to put on a show. He looks like he's fired up at just 19 years old at 135 pounds, making the debut tonight, so a big moment for him.
Two very young fighters here at the Tuff-N-Uff Fighting Championships. Two different approaches. We saw Calvin Agabin as a very cool, calm, collected young man, and Nathan Holbrook looks like he has energy to spend right now. This kid is just a ball of energy right now. Cannot wait to get inside of the Tuff-N-Uff ring.
Yeah, Nate Holbrook has been in training in mixed martial arts for about a year, so since he was 18 years old. You know, it's always exciting to see someone who's 19 going up against an 18-year-old, how much promise these young kids have, how excited they are to get into the Tuff-N-Uff cage and compete. Again, Calvin Agabin went out there and thrilled us last time with his performance. Nate Holbrook wants to come along and spoil that party. Of course, we don't have odds on amateur fights, but from what we saw from Calvin Agabin in his last fight, I would say that he would almost certainly be the odds-on favorite from his one performance.
Holbrook with a bit of a height advantage, though. 5'10", very, very tall at 135.
Staring down his opponent. Let's go.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds in the Tuff-N-Uff Bantamweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner with a record of 1 win and no losses. Fighting out of Ninth Isle BJJ, Las Vegas, Nevada, Calvin Clarkin Agabin. His opponent stands across the cage in the red corner, making his Tuff-N-Uff debut tonight, fighting out of 10th Planet, Las Vegas, Nevada. Here is Nathan Holbrook. Your referee in charge of the action inside the cage is Joe Sullivan.
All right, gentlemen, round one, here we go.
Holbrook not lacking confidence.
Back in your corner, please, sir.
I love it, man. He is fired up and ready to go. Agabin is wearing the white. Holbrook is wearing the black. 2 minutes on the clock, and we are underway. Holbrook immediately pushing forward. Throws a knee, it connects, but Agabin stays very calm. Throws his own kick. Oh, nice shot.
Grounded.
Agabin spinning, looking for that side control. Holbrook does a nice job of getting up and removing himself from an otherwise bad position, and now Holbrook once again throwing punches.
Don't grab the fence! Stop!
Now, what you're seeing here is Joe Sullivan getting vocal, saying stop, because as they were going down, Nate Holbrook grabbed that fence. Again, Holbrook in his debut tonight. Oh, man.
Wow.
Man, Agabin looks good, right?
That head kick followed by a sweep and then immediately jumped on him.
Yeah, he took a shot and then still swept the leg and ended up in top position. And his punches to a down opponent are so accurate.
Those long limbs by Holbrook are causing a little bit of problems for Agabin right now, but he's doing his best to work around him. I mean, like I said, 5'10" at 135 is a very, very tall fighter.
Right, it's a 7-inch difference, and Holbrook has a 76-inch reach. For somebody who's at 135 pounds, it's almost unheard of.
I'm still in awe in that takedown. That was one of the smoothest,
that was awesome
sequences that we've seen in a long time.
Less than 30 seconds left here in round number one, and one thing we have not been short on is action. However, both of these fighters still look very game. I know it's been less than 2 minutes off the clock so far, but both fighters very, very aggressive here in round number one.
Yeah, Holbrook has been active the entire time.
Even
off his back,
he's throwing punches like crazy.
Yeah, we're seeing more power from Agabin on the top, obviously, as he...
Oh, he's got the arm! It's extended! He tapped! That's the end, ladies and gentlemen. Very end of round number one. Calvin Agabin is awesome.
Like the RKO out of nowhere. Wow.
Man, I love watching this kid fight.
That was awesome.
All right, let's watch some of the action here. This is the end of the fight. So he goes for the arm.
Just jumps into it.
Seconds left on the clock. And Holbrook with no option with that arm extended as far as it was. But to tap, even though there was no time left on the clock.
That was a...
So he takes the headshot there, and that was what we were talking about. So he takes a kick to the head. While he takes the kick, he sweeps the leg and then jumps on top and lands a shot, and that's what set up that sequence.
That was awesome. And no fault to Holbrook.
No discredit to Holbrook. He looked great. He was game the entire fight. He looked fantastic. He came out here, you know, obviously amped up, tons of energy, ready to go, but Agabin just too much. What an awesome fighter. Official announcement coming from Justin Bernard. Here we go.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 1 minute, 48 seconds into the first round, referee Joe Sullivan calls a stop to the fight for your winner by tap out due to armbar, Calvin Clarkin Agabin.
Man, we have been cage side for some really unique fighters as we've watched them work their way up the ranks, and obviously here at Tuff-N-Uff, probably one of the most famous, well, scratch that, just obviously the most famous, Ronda Rousey came through these ranks, and she had a lot of these same qualities where no matter what, it seemed like she would always get the finish in the first round, and she would just decimate her opponents, including some very game opponents. Nate Holbrook was a game opponent tonight. He came out looking for a fight, but Calvin Agabin, this young man right here, keep your eye on him. He made his debut a couple of weeks ago and impressed us. That's why we were talking so highly about him. Comes out tonight against a very tough opponent and does it again.
Not an accident, Dave, that's for sure.
That kid is awesome. All right, from the downtown Las Vegas Event Center, this is Barry Myers, world-famous Tough Enough Fighting Championship. We'll be right back with more.
The people of Las Vegas have voted. United Nissan has won the Nissan Global Award 2 years in a row and won the Nissan Award of Excellence 9 times. And right now, vote to save with this incredible deal from United Nissan. 2016 Nissan Sentras, zero down or $119 a month. Plus, test drive any new Nissan and we'll give you a pair of movie tickets just for a test drive. Don't wait. Hurry into United Nissan, East Sahara and Boulder Highway. United Nissan, your Nissan source.
If you, your family, or your friends have been injured, please call 702-644-3333 to schedule an appointment for a free consultation with one of our chiropractic physicians.
Welcome you back to the Downtown Las Vegas Event Center. Great to be with you on a beautiful night here in downtown Las
Vegas. Ladies and gentlemen, making his way to the blue corner, AJ Smith.
AJ Smith at 23 years old, going to be challenged by Alfonso Espinoza tonight at 24 years old. Both fighting out of Las Vegas, Nevada. Excited to see these guys go. First up, AJ Smith. At 155 pounds, he is a tall one. 6'2" at 155 pounds, but looks solid, right?
Oh, I mean,
just
from
the looks of him. Yeah, at lightweight, he looks like a really strong lightweight. Looks like he kind of has that lanky build like John Jones does. 79-inch reach. So
wow, that's huge.
Yeah. Fairfield, California is where he hails from, but he fights out of Las Vegas. He is a Muay Thai fighter and a boxer. Steve Pellegrino is in his corner tonight again. Talked a lot about Steve Pellegrino and the type of fighters that he raises up. He's one of the best in the business. This young man has been fighting in mixed martial arts for the past 6 years, since 2011. So even though he is only 23 years old, he's been around the game since before he could go out and buy a pack of smokes. Not that he would do that, of course. But, you know, since 17 years old, he has been training. So loves to work hard. He's studying film. Nothing special outside of that. He said he just loves to fight and study. Here you go. He is in the ring. Says, wait, one more sip of water. Okay, now I'm ready.
And now making his way to the red corner, Alfonso Espinoza.
Alfonso Espinoza is 5'10", 155 pounds. Trains out of Juan Fight Team, which we were talking about earlier. How fast those guys go. He is undefeated in his young mixed martial arts career, Mahoney. 3-0, so has never lost.
We've got another matchup between Juan Fight Team and Torres MMA, two of the best gyms here in Las Vegas.
He's been training in mixed martial arts for over 6 years as well, said he got into it when he was in high school. Does not know much about his opponent, and that's one of the challenges that you get in Tough Enough. You know, sometimes with these amateur fighters, you know, Tough Enough does it right. Like, we're, you know, in the middle of what looks to be an enormous professional card here in downtown Las Vegas. Like, this is not second rate, but a lot of the smaller shows don't have the same level of production. You can't even find tape on your opponent sometimes, so Alfonso Espinoza says, look, I don't know a lot about my opponent, but I'm coming into this undefeated. I'll be ready to go tonight. Looks like he may have his hands full. AJ Smith looks like a very daunting fighter across the cage right now, but I'll be excited to see how this one shakes out.
It's always interesting to see the confidence of a fighter who's yet to be defeated walking into a cage as well.
Again, 3-0 from Juan Fight Team. Alfonso Espinoza entering the Tough Enough ring, and we are set to go.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds in the Tough Enough Featherweight Division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner with a record of 2 wins and 2 losses, fighting out of Torres MMA, Las Vegas, Nevada, he is AJ the Dragon Smith. His opponent stands across the cage in the red corner with a record of 3 wins and no losses. Fighting out of Juan Fight Team, Las Vegas, Nevada, Alfonso Espinoza. Your referee in charge of the action inside the cage is Mark Smith.
AJ Smith is wearing the black and the red trunks. Alfonso Espinoza is in the gray and the blue. Two minutes on the clock. Total of three potential rounds, and we are underway. Quick touch of the gloves, and they start exchanging. Smith fires off a quick kick to the body. That one landed. Another one to the inside of the leg there. Another one outside of the leg. Yeah, does a nice job of those kicks. Another one to the body.
Espinoza wants to close that distance with that big reach there, Smith.
Yeah, 79 inches. 6'2" for 155-pounder.
Smith is moving, like, very well.
Yeah, Espinoza is pushing forward. Now he's looking for that takedown.
Got it.
Yep. AJ again lists himself as a Muay Thai fighter and as a boxer, so I would imagine that he wants to keep this on his feet. Espinoza, though, realized those kicks were coming fast and furious, so let's go ahead and stop that. Did a nice job of closing the distance, negating that reach.
Stop! Time!
Ended up in top position, but I have to see what's going on here.
Stay here.
Is there a broken finger, maybe?
That's something wrong with the gloves?
Yeah, Marth Smith just called
AJ,
it off.
Go over there.
They're looking at his finger. I think it might be a broken finger.
That's it.
Yep.
That's the end, ladies and gentlemen. AJ Smith gets the victory. TKO. It was probably one of those kicks. I mean, AJ Smith looks very, very upset right now because you can tell that he wants to fight. But, and I mean, obviously, Alfonso Espinoza is also upset. But in the amateur ranks specifically, it is of the utmost importance that fighter safety. We'll take a look at the replay here because, you know, we see him holding up his hand. So this is where the referee noticed something. Oh, yeah. Yep, it's the ring finger on the right hand. You see how it's just all wonky there?
Yep.
Like it's just not holding in the right place. Yeah, it's what? That. And he's trying to bend it. They're taking the gloves off right now. But, I mean, look, AJ Smith has nothing to be ashamed of. I mean, those kicks are probably what did it there, almost certainly. Those were some nasty kicks that he was throwing. We're getting a close-up of that hand in case you really wanted to see what a broken finger looks like. We got the official word there from Justin Bernard. He came over and said TKO via injury. So it is a victory for AJ Smith very early in round number one. Those kicks or maybe something else are what actually broke the finger, but either way, he's got the victory tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 46 seconds into the first round, referee Mark Smith calls a stop to the fight for your winner by TKO due to injury, AJ the Dragon Smith.
Unfortunate to see a fight end that way, but good on Mark Smith for noticing just such a, I mean, almost an
unnoticeable
injury.
All right, fight fans, we are going to go into intermission right now. Go check out all of our wonderful sponsors out here tonight. And we'll be back right here in about 10 minutes for more of Barry Myers' world famous Future Stars of MMA, DJ Ida.
When the insurance company tells you that you don't need an attorney, that's when you know that you need an attorney. Don't deal with the insurance company alone. Make one call, that's all.
Call 877-1500.
If you, your family, or your friends have been injured, please call 702-644-3333 to schedule an appointment for a free consultation with one of our chiropractic physicians.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to bring out the Tuff-N-Uff lightweight division. Making his way to the blue corner, Calvin Parrington.
Beautiful night here in downtown Las Vegas at the Downtown Las Vegas Event Center. Calvin Parrington, 6'1" at 155 pounds. He is 26 years young, fighting out of the School of Hard Knocks. Hometown is Las Vegas. He does have a lot of experience, 5-3, so a winning record certainly. Likes to prepare like a gladiator, he says. I don't know exactly what that means, but it seems like he takes his training very seriously. Got into mixed martial arts when he was just 5 years old, he said, so he's been doing this for a long time. Donnie Bryan is his opponent tonight, who also has some nice experience at 4-3 coming into this one. Brian is coming to us from New Mexico.
Do you think he just like walks around kicking stuff over, yelling, "This is Sparta"?
This is Sparta. Works in landscaping by day and trains the rest of the time, because he wants to see himself in the big leagues, he says. In 5 years from now, he expects to see himself fighting at the top level. And again, you know, a young fighter like himself, lots of promise, shows a well-rounded skill set from everything we've heard. He says that he knows his opponent is a jiu-jitsu fighter and is a wrestler, so he's coming into this prepared for that.
Interesting seeing some of the cupping on the back there of Parrington.
That's what that is.
Yeah.
Yeah, when he first took his shirt off, I was like, what, are those tattoos? No, you're right. Cupping. It's a thing. Calvin Parrington making his way in right now. 155-pounder. The lightweights are getting set to go here in Las Vegas.
And now making his way to the red corner, Donnie Bryan.
Donnie Bryan is 4 inches shorter. He has a 69-inch reach. He is 5'9". Originally from Florida, fighting out of Albuquerque, New Mexico, with one of the best teams in the business. That would be Jackson Wink MMA, where the likes of Donald Cowboy Cerrone and John Jones and Travis Brown and countless others have trained over the years.
Just goes to show you the level of fighters that come here to the Tough Enough Fighting Championships. They come from all over because they know Las Vegas is the fight capital of the world and that all eyes are on them tonight.
Got into mixed martial arts while he was in the U.S. Army. He has been training at the best gym in the world, as he says it. Does not know much about his opponent, so he may be surprised by what he finds. Calvin had done some research on Donnie and figured out that he is a wrestler and a jiu-jitsu fighter, but Donnie Bryan, who we're looking at right now, said, don't really know a lot about my opponent coming into this one. Just plans on fighting his own fight. Not so much worried about what his opponent is going to do. Always interesting to hear fighter strategies on that. Donnie Bryan making his way into the ring right now. We are set to go here at Tough Enough.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds in the Tough Enough lightweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner with a record of 5 wins and 3 losses. Fighting out of the School of Hard Knocks, Las Vegas, Nevada, Calvin Parrington. His opponent stands across the cage in the red corner with a record of 4 wins and 3 losses. Fighting out of Jackson Wink, Albuquerque, New Mexico, Donnie Bryan. Inside the cage is Joe Sullivan.
All right, gentlemen, round one. Are you ready to fight, sir? You ready to fight? Here we go. Fight!
3 2-minute rounds. Parrington is in the red and the gray. Donnie Bryan is in the black, and nice right hand there from Parrington to start it out, followed by a knee to the body. Bryan looking for that takedown, was trying to get the hip toss, unable to do it. And now Parrington has the back going for his own slam. Bryan does a nice job of not allowing that to happen. But Parrington has the back at this point.
Looking
He's
for that
got
arm.
The arm. He's got it extended. Bryan doing a nice job of spinning out of it.
Two seasoned MMA fighters here. Both these guys, Parrington with 8 fights, Bryan with 7. These guys have seen the inside of a cage. They know what to do.
Yeah, Parrington had that arm, and it was fully extended. He's going for the arm again. Bryan did a nice job of working his way out of that.
Nice little chess match there.
Yep, some high-level jiu-jitsu. Even though it's the amateur ranks, these guys don't fight like the old-school amateurs did. These guys fight like the old-school pros did, and better in a lot of cases. Bryan goes ahead and pulls guard there, brings Parrington down to the ground.
Let's work.
Parrington in top position. Less than a minute left here in round number one, just about 50 seconds.
Stay busy.
Parrington has spent the majority of this fight in top position.
Bryan doing a good job neutralizing Parrington right now, though.
Yeah, he has gone ahead and brought that leg behind the head
can
of
he
Parrington to
pull
him down.
I was gonna say, can he squeak it around, go for a go-go plata, but goes back to full guard.
That would be something. We have seen it before here at Tough Enough, believe
have.
It or not. Yeah.
Bryan showing that he's very flexible and very good off of his back, both of these fighters.
Yeah, and really utilizing his legs to lock up the limbs of Parrington.
Looking for the shoulder.
Yeah.
Kind of got Parrington tied up here a bit.
Yeah, Parrington's tied up, but
he's laughing
at him. So final 10 seconds here of round number one, and that's the end.
Interesting position that Brian put Parrington there in at the end.
I don't know what Brian said to him, like, I got you, or something like that. And Parrington just looked at him and went, ah, do you, though? All right, so interesting round number one. Parrington definitely was the one that's going to get the nod on our unofficial scorecard for this armbar attempt here. So he rolled with it. You see the arm is fully extended underneath his body. A pretty bad position for Brian there. But Brian did a nice job of pivoting out and getting away from his arm really being in danger and ended up in top position there.
Yeah, a really good, well-balanced first round. I said we saw some good striking. We saw a lot of good escapes. We saw a lot of good submission attempts there. I think it may be harder than we think to call that first round in some of the judges' eyes, Dave.
Now, you could be right, but I mean, I think that Parrington had the moment where he really threatened Brian with a finish.
I agree.
He also got the better of the exchange when they were on their feet. So while Brian is certainly very game and very much in this fight, I think round number one pretty clearly went the way of Parrington.
A little water. Can't have that.
Corners, make sure your fighter comes out dry in between rounds. Ready to fight, sir? Ready? Here we go. Fight!
Round number two is underway. Parrington is in the red and the gray. Brian is in the black. Interesting to see the strategy here in round number two. And Parrington, once again, has the back and quickly trying to flatten out Brian.
Got that arm under there.
He does. He's got it under the chin. This could be it.
Well,
it's pretty tight. This could be it.
Fight back.
I think that's it.
He is out.
Yeah. He was trying to fight it, but there's actually drool coming out of his mouth right now.
Wow.
He didn't actually tap.
No, he did not.
But he went out.
And that was a good stoppage there by Joe Sullivan. I mean, he was out for the briefest of seconds.
Yep.
We saw his eyes. I mean, we were parallel to him.
Here it is. You see, he's telling him to fight back, and Sullivan, you can see, is down on the ground on all fours, watching it very closely. This is where he flattened him out, and he saw those fingers just go limp there for a moment. And
he was
going to tap there. Yeah.
It was close.
Beautifully done. Calvin Parrington. Very impressive in this fight. No matter where it went, he looked phenomenal. Striking, when we saw that early on in round number one, did a great job closing that down. And when it went to the ground, I mean, Donnie Bryan trains one of the best gyms in the world, in Jackson Wink. Looked like he was very good on the ground. However, Parrington just kind of overwhelmed him.
It was some unorthodox jiu-jitsu that we saw there from Parrington, and I think that caught Bryan off guard, which eventually led to Parrington getting this victory. Very impressed tonight by this performance.
With the official announcement, here is Justin Bernard.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 36 seconds into the second round, your winner by tap out to the rear naked choke, Calvin Parrington.
So they are calling that a tap out from rear naked choke.
There was one tap.
There did come a hand there. And again, Sullivan did a great job of shutting that down exactly when it needed to happen. So 155-pound fight. That was a fun one. We're moving on to the 135ers. This is Tough Enough from the downtown Las Vegas Event Center. We're coming right back.
Federally insured by the NCUA Equal Opportunity Lender.
Now, why would you go to the dealership? Your time is money. And let's be honest, free is not free. So don't go to the dealership. Come on into Terrible's. Check out our new low-price oil change special. You can get an oil change for only $19.95. Yeah, $19.95. So pull into any lube and ask for details. Terrible's Lube and More. More than just an oil change.
Fight fans!
Are you ready for a war?
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's bring out the Tuff-N-Uff Bantamweight Division. Making his way to the blue corner, Julius Lopez.
Julius Lopez is 135 pounds, just 22 years old, stands 5'8", which is very respectable for a 135-pounder, 76-inch reach. Fighting style is Muay Thai and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Has a lot of experience, 5-5. So he's coming into this one with 10 amateur fights to his credit.
Again, fighting on 9th Isle BJJ here in Las Vegas. They've had a good showing here tonight. Two of their other fighters both coming away victorious.
Brandon Rios also has some nice experience at 3-2. He is just 20 years old, hailing from the state of Utah. But Julius Lopez, as you said, Mahoney, they've had a lot of success tonight out of their camp with 9th Isle Jiu-Jitsu, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. And I'm excited to see what this young man brings, because with 10 amateur fights, he's certainly gotten over the jitters. He's gotten over, you know, some of the other things that come early on in a career where you're having to kind of learn live, you know. At 10 fights, he's at the point now at 5-5 where I think you can start to make a determination what happens in these next couple of fights if he's going to pursue this hard as a professional career.
He's still a young man, still has a lot of years ahead of him if he wants to continue to fight.
At just 22 years old, very excited to see what he brings in tonight. So here you go. 5'5", that is Julius Lopez, set to fight tonight here at Tuff-N-Uff.
And now making his way to the red corner, Brandon Rios.
Brandon Rios is just 20 years old, fighting out of St. George, Utah. His hometown is right here in Las Vegas. Trains out of Fusion MMA, lists himself as a wrestler. 5'6" at 135 pounds. Got into mixed martial arts when he was in his sophomore year of high school. Says that he's been preparing for this fight with hard work and dedication. Really looks up to George St. Pierre as a fighter. Loves that respectful, humble attitude that he brings. So will be interesting to see how he does in this fight tonight. But again, he also brings experience in 3-2. So he's got 5 amateur fights to his credit. And he is currently sitting with a winning record.
We've seen a lot of fighters here in the Tuff-N-Uff Fighting Championships coming out of St. George, Fusion MMA in particular. Very tough gym. A lot of good training going on over there in St. George.
So Brandon Rios, again, lists himself as a wrestler, while his opponent, Julius Lopez, says that he is a Muay Thai fighter and a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu fighter. So you've got 3 very distinct styles there that basically make up all of mixed martial arts at this point. And They don't mesh any of them. You got one guy saying Muay Thai and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, the other guy saying straight wrestling. So it'll be interesting to see how this one shakes out.
Yeah, I love seeing the traditional striker versus grappler matchup, Dave. Always interesting to see who's going to get the better of that.
But now to blow your mind, the wrestler is wearing Muay Thai shorts.
Is he trying to get in his mind?
Mental
Jiu-Jitsu. That's what's going on right there, Dave.
All right, here we go. 135-pounder set to go at Tuff-N-Uff. Beautiful night in Las Vegas. We're ready for another scrap.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is in the Tuff-N-Uff Bantamweight Division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner with a record of 5 wins and 5 losses. Fighting out of 9th Isle BJJ, Las Vegas, Nevada, Julius Lopez. His opponent stands across the cage in the red corner with a record of 3 wins and 2 losses. Fighting out of Fusion MMA, St. George, Utah, Brandon Prince Rios. Your referee in charge of the action inside the cage is Mark Smith.
3 2-minute rounds. Lopez is wearing the blue. Rios is wearing the white. Cage doors are closed and we are set to go.
Julius, ready? Brandon, ready? Fight's on.
Round number 1 is underway. Touch of the gloves, and we're off. Outside leg kick there from Rios. Another one. Whoa.
That was interesting.
certainly not lacking confidence on his feet. I mean, he listed himself as a wrestler, comes in wearing the Muay Thai shorts, but he looks like he is throwing some nice Muay Thai knees there and certainly very proficient on his feet as well.
Landing some good strikes there in that exchange.
Yeah, Lopez is doing a nice job slowing a lot of those punches down, but he hasn't really had a chance to mount any offense. And Rios landing a couple of more there, almost got the takedown.
Seeing a little bit of that wrestling. Doing a good job of muscling him.
Yeah, and keep in mind that Lopez is the taller fighter. He definitely has a reach advantage, but Rios doing a nice job of negating that, getting inside. Looked like he was going to throw a flying knee instead. Picks him up, slams him, takes him to the ground.
Ooh. Rolled into a punch.
Yeah.
He's landing some nice punches there. Those are big shots. Mark Smith is telling Julius to fight back, and another slam. Man, Brandon Rios is all over him right now.
Lopez is trying to get out, though. He's doing his best, but Rios is just all over him. Looking for another slam.
And he does so right in front of the broadcast booth here. Rios continues to not just elevate and slam, but also peppering him with punches constantly. Again, Mark Smith is all over the action here. Just about 25 seconds left in round number one. But Brandon Rios with another slam directly in front of the broadcast booth. Man, he is just overwhelming him right now. Has not given Lopez an opportunity to try to set up any offense. Final 10 seconds of round number one. And this, he's cranking the arm now. He's looking for that arm. He's got a pin behind his back. He's going for the Americana. That is the end of round number one.
Wow, that was intense.
Sure was, man. Brandon Rios all over him.
Just swarmed him. Saw some interesting striking, and then that wrestling came in the second half of that round. I think we saw, maybe four takedowns at that point?
Yeah, I mean, Brandon Rios just at will was able to grab him and elevate him, and it's because Lopez just didn't know what was coming. I mean, Rios did a great job coming out. He threw some very nice kicks and some knees to sort of start things off, and then the rest of the fight looked just like this, or the rest of the round, rather, looked just like that, where he was constantly peppering him, and the second that Lopez started to get back to his feet, elevated, slammed again.
Lopez wasn't able to get off his jiu-jitsu from the ground either. We saw him try to scramble, look for something, but Rios just wasn't having it. I think we're seeing a pretty distinct strength difference between Rios and Lopez, and I think giving that edge, quite a big edge to Rios as far as the strength goes, because we saw him muscle Lopez around the entire cage.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what the strategy is for Lopez after talking to his corner and having a minute to kind of say, hang on, let's kind of reset a little bit here. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
Time.
Mark Smith is calling time. It's around. The tape on. Right, have something on his back?
Doc, is that it?
He had maybe a cut or a scratch or something on his back?
Maybe a dermal? No, if you have a scratch, I don't think they would be covering it up.
I don't think so either.
I've seen them do this with dermals in the past, and I've seen them do it with if you have gauges in the ears, but I'm not sure exactly what they're doing.
Okay, take it off.
Oh, no, not a dermal. I don't know.
They're right here.
That was interesting.
Yeah, I couldn't tell what that was from that camera shot. They're right up on it, but.
Stop talking and fight. You understand? Tom in. Fight.
Round number two, we are underway. And Lopez getting aggressive here. He's got Rios backing up at the beginning of round number two. Switch kick there, went inside of the leg and then went to the head. And Lopez, this is where he got in trouble last time. So kind of surprised to see him close the distance.
He goes clean.
He's go by really quickly, just 90 seconds left here in round number two.
Rios being somewhat almost too confident, I think. You know, keeping his hands a little bit low earlier on, he's got them back up now, but.
And does a nice job there, a little hip toss. Gets Lopez down once again. Let's see if he's able to keep him there. Lopez has done a nice job of scrambling back to his feet every single time that Rios has elevated him or tossed him to the ground. Rios really, like you said, keeping his hands pretty low, not really afraid of the power of Lopez,
yep.
But he's eaten a lot of shots in the process.
He has, but it doesn't seem to stop him, though.
Doesn't stop him at all, but still, it only takes one punch.
And I think we see. I think we're seeing that strength differential there. I think we're seeing. Ooh, he got tagged in the eye. But I don't know if that was a finger. Was that a finger?
I couldn't tell from the angle that we were at because
right
it was the outside eye from where we're actually sitting. And maybe we'll get a replay here. But there was definitely a moment where you know he backed up and winced. And yeah. You know, Mark Smith doing a nice job there, immediately detecting it and calling time. But the doctor's going to take a look here.
Yeah, you could see Rios wince in pain immediately after the contact there, be it from a knuckle or from a finger. It was hard to tell.
Yeah, here's the replay. So let's see if we can tell. It was kind of pawing with that hand, the
left
hand.
Yeah, so. I was looking at his right when he threw it, and it didn't look like there was fingers extended, but there were in his left hand there.
We are back underway in round number two. Lopez saying sorry about that, unintentional eye poke, and Rios throws a head kick. Less than 30 seconds left here in round number two. This round much, much closer.
He's keeping his hands real low.
He just kind of put him on his hips there, kind of taunt Lopez.
Ooh.
Oh, that one stumbled Lopez. Caught him coming in.
Lopez still trying to move forward, but for a takedown.
He gets it.
Stop.
Boy.
Nice finish there for Lopez. I don't know if it's going to be enough to win that round for him, but that was a...
Well, Rios didn't do anything, though. I mean, like, Rios caught him with that punch, but it didn't drop him. It did stumble him,
yeah.
So that was significant, but Lopez, up to that point, he certainly hadn't lost the round.
Yeah.
He didn't convincingly win it, but it's not like Rios was just dominating him. There wasn't much going on there. I mean, Rios was kind of taunting him and just toying with him throughout that entire second round.
And looking here at the replay, you could see, he did land
that. That was a nice left hand right there. Caught him right on the chin and stumbled him. But again, to Lopez's credit,
he's
recovered very well every single time that he has gotten a big shot. You know, he's taken some serious shots, Mahoney, but either way, how you guys doing? Thank you guys for watching. Every single time that he's landed with a big shot, Lopez has fought right back. So he's gotten dumped on his head numerous times, but every single time he's gotten right back up. Rios, round number one, overwhelmed Lopez. Round number two, like you said, maybe overly confident,
yep.
Kept his hands low, didn't really engage that much. These rounds are short. Anything can happen. At the end of round number two there, Lopez very easily could have stolen that round, in my opinion.
The Nevada State Athletic Commission, we've got, along with the ISKA, has some of the best judges here in the world. And so we got some great judges here tonight. This easily could be 1-1.
I think you're right. Third and final round. And Lopez comes out swinging once again. Rios looking to possibly get a trip. Lopez doing the same.
Lopez landed on that exchange on the way out, which is why we saw the taunt there from Rios.
And
getting a little flashy.
Yeah, getting flashy, but he ends up on his back.
Yep.
And Lopez there as he's coming up.
Ate a couple jabs.
Yep.
Lopez is on to that game. He's
yep. So what Rios does is when he throws those body kicks, he's going for the submission here. He's looking for this arm.
He's
got it extended.
Nice roll
again,
there.
Lopez rolls right out of it.
And gets his back.
Yeah.
And he's got his arm under his neck.
Lopez may be stealing this fight right away from Rios. There's only a minute left in this entire fight, and so far this round, Lopez has been a very, very game fighter.
It's an awkward position right there from the side. You're not going to finish. It's going to be very hard to finish the submission, but he gives it up, and now we've got Rios up on top. Is Lopez going to be able to get up with just 50 seconds left?
Well, I would be shocked if he couldn't. Yeah, there you go. He rolls it into full mount. He's in full mount.
Who needs to get up when he can roll it into full mount and go
for
an arm?
Now he's got the arm. Jeez. This fight is everywhere. It's literally everywhere.
Yep.
The second we're like, okay, this guy's starting to dominate and win, that changes. It looks like Rios is wincing in pain. No, he's just
looking at determination.
Yeah, just a
but
grimace.
Lopez is working some interesting submissions. He's got a triangle in. I don't know if he can finish it from there.
Yeah,
probably
it's
not.
Really, really
but he's
hard
certainly
to do.
Stifling his offense.
And again, he's looking for that arm.
Yep. Can he? 10 seconds left.
Yeah, and I mean Rios doing a nice job of circling away from the danger. Now he's the one that's landing punches, but Lopez again back to his feet. That is the end of the fight. Boy,
wow.
This is not an easy one for the judges, in my opinion. I mean, round number one,
clearly,
all Brandon Rios.
Yes.
No, not even close. Round number two, very close. I actually edged Julius Lopez. I thought that with that takedown there at the end of round number two, I gave that to him because even though he got stumbled, it was just very briefly.
Yep.
He didn't go down. He just kind of got rocked on one single punch.
And you got to remember, there was an intermission from the eye poke, and he finished that round strong, too.
Yep. And then the third round there, I think that Lopez stole this fight away from Brandon Rios. And I think that he got a little bit too confident there.
I think Rios let this fight get – I think Rios let this fight get away from him. I think that fight was his for the taking. Wanted to do a little trash talking there. But I think he's going to come away with this. I think he is, but it's going to be a lot closer than it should be. I think there is a possibility of a split decision, as we see just lots of offense there at the end. We saw Rios land a few punches at the end of round number three, but that's definitely not enough to give him that third round because Lopez was just going for submission after submission after submission.
Now, interestingly, what's going on right now is that Justin Bernard, who is the ring announcer, is walking around. He's getting the scorecards from the judges to make the official announcement, but as you'll notice, this is taking just a little bit longer than usual, which means there was some deliberation. He's walking into the ring right now. This one very close. Can't wait to see who our winner is. Here's the official announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of war, we have your winner by majority decision, Brandon Prince Rios!
There you have it. Brandon Rios came out in round number one, absolutely dominant. Slowed down in round number two, but I guess the judges gave round number two to him because round number three, I think, pretty clearly went the other direction. However, one of the judges did disagree there. So split decision victory for Brandon Rios. No question about it. In round number one, he looked powerful. He looked dominant. Came out, gets the victory tonight. So that's all that matters. Maybe adjust a couple of things to make sure he can finish better. Have that same sort of performance in the later rounds like he did in the first round. But nice job there by Brandon Rios.
And fun fight. Nice little homage there pointing to the pink ribbon on his shorts. For breast cancer awareness, he's very emotional right now, and a lot of good sportsmanship. I like seeing that at the end of a fight.
Sticking with the 135ers, our co-main event is coming up next. This is Tough Enough, live from Las Vegas.
Las Vegas have voted. United Nissan has won the Nissan Global Award 2 years in a row and won the Nissan Award of Excellence 9 times. And right now, vote to save with this incredible deal from United Nissan. 2016 Nissan Sentras, zero down or $119 a month. Plus, test drive any new Nissan and we'll give you a pair of movie tickets just for a test drive. Don't wait. Hurry into United Nissan, East Sahara and Boulder Highway. United Nissan, your Nissan source.
We are back live in Las Vegas. Dave Farah, Jason Mahoney, great to be with you. It turned out to be a beautiful night here in Las Vegas. A little bit worried with the
weather
earlier
today. Ladies and gentlemen,
today,
who's ready for the co-main event of the evening? Making his way to the blue corner, Danny Gonzalez.
Danny Gonzalez, 7-2 at 33 years old. He hails from California. He has been around this game for a long time, and at 7-2 as an amateur, he's got a lot of experience, and they do a great job matching up these guys that have a lot of experience, so that way it's not lopsided. Danny Gonzalez comes into this fight with a wealth of experience, not just with his record at 7-2, but also he's been training in mixed martial arts for almost a decade, Mahoney, since 2008.
Yeah, Tough Enough bringing some of the best fighters from all around the world, all around the country. Guys looking to make their pro debuts maybe after this. Is he going to go pro? Like I said, this is his 10th fight. Should be interesting to see where he goes after this fight.
Says a lot of hard training, lots of cardio leading up to this one. Danny Gonzalez looks to be in great shape, entering the Tough Enough ring for the co-main event right now.
Thank you.
And now making his way to the red corner, Corey Conway.
Corey Conway hails from Guam, now lives here in Las Vegas, and trains out of, any guesses, Mahoney?
Extreme Couture.
That's right. Good
We've
job.
Called a few of Corey Conway's fights. I believe we called his very first fight several years ago here at Tuff-N-Uff. And interesting fact, he was actually supposed to fight about a month ago, made weight, got to it, and his opponent could not make weight. So delayed about a month from fighting, but still in phenomenal shape. This kid is always fun to watch.
Yeah, and he's been training in mixed martial arts since he was 7 years old, so 14 years ago. He's just 21, but basically his entire life, he's been a mixed martial artist. And when asked how he was preparing for this fight, he said yoga in the park. I don't know if he's being serious or not, but...
You ever done yoga?
Yes, it's hard.
Yeah, man, I was trying to do a plank. Well, it's like 5 seconds.
Really, a conditioned athlete like yourself, Mahoney?
I know it's hard to believe that I could only hold a plank for 5 seconds. But, you know, it's interesting. We've seen some, non-traditional training methods from some of the bigger fighters like Conor McGregor as well, hiring a movement coach. So yoga in the park? I mean, obviously it hasn't hurt his physique one bit.
Well, let's see if it pays off. Again, co-main event tonight at 135 pounds, fighting out of Extreme Couture, one of the finest gyms in the world, right here in Las Vegas. This is Corey Conway, has a record of 6-3. Can he improve that to 7-3 against a very game opponent in Danny Diehard Gonzalez, who stands across the cage from him at 7-2? They're taping up his shorts right now, making a couple of adjustments, I guess, just to tighten that down a bit, maybe? I don't know if I've ever seen this before, where they actually are like running duct tape around the shorts. Have you seen this before?
I have not. Yeah. This is interesting. Huh. There's apparently no sagging rule that we are unaware of.
Keep your pants up, kid. Now get in the ring and fight.
Or maybe he's a red belt.
That could be it. All right, here we go with the official announcements.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the co-main event of the evening, scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds in the Tuff-N-Uff bantamweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner with a record of 7 wins and 2 losses, fighting out of the Guild Rosemead, California, Danny Diehard Gonzalez. His opponent stands across the cage in the red corner with a record of 6 wins and 3 losses, fighting out of Extreme Couture, Las Vegas, Nevada. Here is Corey Conway. Your referee in charge of the action inside the cage is Joe Sullivan.
All right, gentlemen, we went over the rules. Protect yourself at all times. Obey my commands at all times. If it's stop, you must stop. Touch goes if you want. Go back to your corner. Be ready to fight.
Danny Gonzalez is wearing the red and the black. Corey Conway is wearing the green with the red tape belt.
All right, are you ready? Ready, round one, here we go. Fight!
3 2-minute rounds and we are off.
Keep your fingers closed.
Conway quickly fires a kick. Gonzalez answers back.
Fingers closed.
Nice right there by Conway. A little bit of a feeling out period here.
Yeah, but Conway's very deliberate with his strikes. Gonzalez did a nice job landing a couple on that exchange. But a lot of power behind Conway's strikes.
Ooh.
Caught him on that one, yep.
Ooh,
he stumbled him.
He's dancing. Ooh, big knee there. Ooh, nice shot by Gonzalez, too.
Yeah, Gonzalez landed a nice shot on the break there.
Some blood over the right eye of Gonzalez that he got caught. I don't know if that was from a punch or if that was from a clash of the heads there when the exchange just happened. But we will see some blood on Gonzalez when they pan in close.
Yeah, you're right, Mahoney. Starting to roll down the right cheek of Gonzalez there. About 45 seconds left here in round number one. A lot of big punches. Oh, Gonzalez doing a nice job with the knees up against the cage. Landed a looping left hand as well.
Tried to knock Conway down, but nice stuff there.
Yeah, went for the hip toss and ended up in bottom position up against the cage. Not a great spot to be in. Just over 20 seconds left here in round number one, though, so I'd be surprised if Conway's going to be able to do a lot with it. However, it certainly leaves an impression in the judges' eyes.
And this was a nice little break because Conway was eating some shots there from Gonzalez, but now throwing some nice ones of his own.
Final 10 seconds here of round number one.
Two guys with a lot of power.
A lot of power.
Go grab the fence.
Especially for 135-pounders, right? And look at this, Gonzalez going for that arm. Conway did a nice job of stuffing that as well. Interesting round. How do you see that one, Mahoney?
I would have to give that one to Gonzalez just because I think he landed more strikes. But it was very close, you know. I mean, we see some blood. That cut is on the corner of Gonzalez's right eye, as we can see the cut man right there working on it. I'm curious to see, you know, because like I said, this is amateur MMA and fighter safety is paramount. They're going to take a close look at that because, you know, if it's going to come close to the eye, they may stop it. Looks like Joe Sullivan is walking away from Gonzalez, so it doesn't look like he's going to stop the fight right now.
Yeah, it does look like it's above the brow, and it may have happened. Okay, so this is the point where Gonzalez, really nice job with the knees there. That left landed big, and then he came back in with more knees. The mistake that he made here, and, you know, you could never have predicted this, but he went for the takedown thinking he could hurt his opponent, ended up in the bottom position.
But you got to remember, Conway did stun him earlier on in the round, too, which is such a hard round to call. Very evenly matched.
Yeah, Gonzalez is the one that would get that one on my unofficial scorecard. But here we go, on to round number two.
Keep your fingers closed.
Gonzalez again in the red and the black. Conway's in the green.
Big kick there by Gonzalez.
Another big kick to the body. I mean, Conway's checking him, but that's got to hurt the arms, too.
I just love the look of determination on Conway's face. He always is pushing forward and just always laser focused. Gonzalez's mouth's a little open. Taking some deep breaths.
Yeah, even though they're only, you know, about 3 minutes into this fight, a lot of action there in round number one. Conway threw a looping right hand that just missed the chin. Conway throwing a lot of those teep kicks.
Just Gonzalez just going to... Yeah, no problem throwing those kicks.
Gonzalez picked up on what Conway's doing, where he's scooping a lot of those kicks. He's reaching for the kicks that Gonzalez is throwing lower, that Gonzalez is throwing lower. Conway's trying to grab him. I'll be curious to see if Gonzalez is going to start to go higher with some of those kicks.
Gonzalez did land a head kick, didn't do too much damage, but he's, in my opinion, has been having more success with his hands.
Conway with a nice kick to the body there. Yeah. 15 seconds left here in round number two. Again, a very, very close one. If somebody gets a takedown here. Oh, nice shot there from Conway. Stumbled Gonzalez for a moment. That could be what steals the round. I mean, that was a really close
one,
right?
Very evenly matched round there.
Don't forget the official after party is happening at the D.
I don't know if they would be able to see Gonzalez stumbling right there, because even from my particular viewpoint, it was hard to see his feet.
Yeah, so Gonzalez landed a nice shot too, but that was a shot right there where it stumbled him a little bit. And Gonzalez did a nice job of recovering. So, again, great point. It depends where the judges are sitting, what their vantage position is as to what they're going to see. Corey Conway is sitting right now on his stool, and he looks very, very calm, very cool and collected. Gonzalez has been breathing a little bit deeper, but he also looks like he certainly has a lot of fight left in him. So it'll be interesting to see how this third and final round goes. But so far, very close.
I think it comes down to this third and final round, Dave. I really do. I think whoever brings it and whoever wins this round is going to win the fight.
Thanks, Justin. Here we go.
Gonzalez in the red and the black. Conway is in the green. Anyone's fight. Here we go, third and final round. Oh man, Gonzalez gets rocked hard. Conway is all over him too. He's going for the neck now, looking for the submission. Standing guillotine, he's cranking. Gonzalez pops his head out. Nice recovery by Gonzalez. But boy, he got rocked hard.
That was a big shot. Joe Sullivan was very close to stopping that. Good recovery, though, by Gonzalez, though.
Stay busy.
He just lost his mouthpiece.
Gonzalez for the slam, and down he goes.
I don't know if Joe's seen that Gonzalez has lost his mouthpiece.
No heel kicks to the kidney.
Conway making that statement that he needed to make here in this third and final round. If he wants to put an exclamation point on this fight. Again, very close first two rounds.
Conway trying to transition, doing a good job controlling Gonzalez, getting ready to probably take his back
Stay
here.
Busy.
Maybe not. Oh, no, he's looking for his arm. Wow, great
Gonzalez.
Transition from Gonzalez.
Flips him out of it. Now he's looking for the arm, but Conway ties his head up.
They just traded arms.
Now, Conway still has that arm of Gonzalez. He's trying. It's going to be hard to finish from that point because, pushes him back.
Gonzalez.
Final 20 seconds of this fight.
Gonzalez does not have a mouthpiece.
Gonzalez is going to end this fight in top position unless Conway can do exactly this. And he reverses, and now he's in top position. But Gonzalez has that neck cranking, just not enough time. Who knows how the judges scored the first two rounds. But Corey Conway did a great job in round number three, turning it on, doing exactly what he needed to do to make that statement in a very close fight.
I do not envy the judges in this particular case. The only definitive round was this third round by Corey Conway.
And that was a shot right there. Big right hand directly to the chin, drops Gonzalez down. And then this was also another big moment where he just picks him up, elevates him, and just dumps him right on his back.
Great co-main event tonight here in Las Vegas. Two guys making their 10th fight in the Tuff-N-Uff Fighting Championships cage. And both look great.
Yeah, both fighters are waiting for the announcement, and Justin Bernard is walking in right now, looking down at the judges' scorecards. Here comes the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, after a three-round war, we have your winner by unanimous decision, Corey Conway!
Not going to argue with that one bit. I think the judges probably got it right. Don't know exactly how they scored rounds one and two, but round number three was all Corey Conway. So if he had any one of the first two rounds, which is very, very plausible, then that big round three certainly was the winning round for him.
Love the poise of this young fighter. 10 fights and 21 years old. He's got a big future ahead of him.
Future stars of MMA, that's what you're seeing at Tuff-N-Uff. We got ourselves a title fight in the 145-pound division, and that's coming up next, live from Las Vegas.
Fight fans, are you ready for a war?
This is the original light beer. Brewed to be everything you want in a beer and less. Miller Lite. Hold true.
All right, fight fans, who's ready for the main event of the evening? Make some noise! Making their way to the blue corner, Billy Brand.
This should be a fun one. For the Tuff-N-Uff title at 145 pounds, we got Billy Brand. He's got a record of 7-1 versus Ian King, 8-3. Billy Brand, the junior of Ian King, by a full 7 years. Billy Brand, at just 20 years old, Mahoney, he's got 8 fights to his credit.
And fighting for a belt tonight.
Ian King, at just 27 years old, also very experienced. He's got 11 fights to his credit. So Billy Brand, coming to us from Folsom, California. Fights out of the MMA Gold Fight Team. Lists himself as a Muay Thai fighter. Again, 7-1 at just 20 years old, 145 pounds. This is exactly the sort of prospect that so many of the leagues are looking for out there. Got into mixed martial arts when he was 12 years old. So even though he's only 20, he's got 8 years of experience as an MMA fighter.
Yeah, which is about 2009.
Yep. Grinding all day, every day is what he says that he does.
Well, it's led him here to the Tuff-N-Uff Fighting Championships to fight for the 145-pound belt, which is very prestigious.
Full-time fighter. That's what he does with his life, and excited to see him compete
tonight. And the last man to walk out tonight, making his way to the red corner, Ian King.
Ian King stands at 5'10", so he will be significantly taller. Billy Brand at 5'6", has a 70-inch reach advantage, which is pretty significant for a 145-pounder. Fighting out of Portland, Oregon, again, he has got a record of 8-3. And he comes into this not really knowing anything about his opponent, but he said, look, I train 6 days a week in three different disciplines. I'm a well-rounded fighter, and I'm ready to prove that tonight.
Yeah, very tall for 145, coming in almost at 6 foot tall. You know, very tall, very, very lean, in incredible shape, and pretty good amateur record so far at 8-3.
I mean, this sounds pretty awesome. Other than fighting in MMA, what do? He said, I sleep.
I can relate.
It's good.
Yeah.
It's good.
I mean, you got to get those 8 hours.
Got to get that rest, man. Mm-hmm. Looks up to his father. Looks to be fighting professionally in 5 years. And Frankie Edgar and Randy Couture. And Sakuraba also made the list
okay.
of the fighters that he looks up to. Says also well-rounded Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and Muay Thai. Those are his specialties. And he's also training in multiple disciplines almost every single day of the week. So excited to see Ian King, who will walk away with the championship. Now, championship fights here in Tuff-N-Uff, we do have a little bit longer, so we have three-minute rounds, so these guys have a little bit more time to do their work. Here's the official announcements.
Tonight's fights are sanctioned by the ISKA. In attendance tonight is Nevada State Director and scorekeeper Carlos Canton, timekeeper Troy Mazzagatti, and our judges Kate Side are Chad Lyman, Mike Bland, and Larry Meir. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event of the evening. Scheduled for three-minute rounds, all for the Tuff-N-Uff Featherweight Championship. Fight fans, it's about to go down. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner with a record of 7 wins and 1 loss. Fighting out of MMA Gold, El Dorado Hills, California, Billy His opponent stands across the cage in the red corner with a record of 8 wins and 3 losses. Fighting out of Grace Ibarra, Portland, Oregon, he is Ian King. Your referee in charge of the action inside the cage is Mark Chappie Smith.
Gentlemen, for the featherweight title, you got your instructions earlier. Protect yourself at all times. Obey my commands. Touch gloves. Come out ready to fight.
Three-minute rounds. Billy Brand is wearing the white shorts tonight. Ian King is in the blue. Cage doors are closed. Mark Smith is our referee. Round number one for the featherweight championship here at Tuff-N-Uff. It's underway. No touch of the gloves.
Let's go, Billy!
Careful, knees to the head, Ian.
Hey, nice job, Billy.
Ian King, again, the much taller fighter, has that reach advantage. Billy seems comfortable just sort of letting him in this feeling out process throw all the strikes. Billy has yet to fire back. There you go.
Nice flexibility there from King.
King keeps looking for that takedown, and Billy just shrugs it off.
Yep.
Just out of it in an instant.
Good counter there from that leg kick. Got a little bit more time, so don't have to immediately rush at each other. being a championship fight.
Extra minute in each round. Coming up on the halfway point of round number one, and King there. Nice little switch kick, that one landed a bit. He's got Billy pushed up against the cage. He's pushing forward now on Brand. But Brand circles back and once again takes the center of the cage. Outside leg kick from Brand, lands hard to that left leg of King.
Brand able to close that distance pretty much at will right now, though.
And Brand looks really confident. King does a nice job there.
Good takedown.
Getting that trip. Ends up in top position. This could be a really good moment for him, considering there's a minute left in this round. And while Brand has looked very confident, he has landed some, you know, hard kicks to the leg. He hasn't really done anything significant up to this point. So a very effective way, with just about a minute remaining, get that takedown and finish the round in top position. If Brand can't scramble out here, King may just do that.
Brand's got very dirty feet.
Yes, he does. Thank you for noticing, Ronnie.
King doing a good job of just controlling Brand right now.
Yeah, similar. Brand was doing a pretty good job of controlling King there until he got that left arm out and was able to start to throw some punches to the body. Before that, Brand had him pretty tied up. And you see Brand is looking for an arm. Not going to have enough time, though. Final seconds here of round number one. And King ends the round with a nice statement. I mean, not just the final minute there where he was in top position, but even when they got up, got very aggressive there in the final seconds. Round number one on my unofficial scorecard going to Ian King.
I'm with you there. Not a lot of damage done, but I think the as far as position goes, King definitely controlled it for more time than Brand had given him that round.
Taking a look at the replay here, some of the action. It was King getting that big trip. That's what led to the takedown. Nice move by him that, again, gave him a solid minute of control on the ground while they were on the feet and going back and forth. There was a decent amount of exchange and back and forth, but when King got him to the ground, did a nice job of controlling the fight there.
Yeah, we're looking at King right now, looking very intensely into his trainer's eyes, taking instruction.
Yeah, and Brand looks very confident still. He's also doing a nice job of just remaining calm, listening to his corner, but at the same time, I mean, he's actually dancing right now.
Very relaxed. I mean, if you're going to bust out some dance moves in the cage in between rounds.
In a championship fight.
In Las Vegas.
All right, here we go. Round number two.
Nice body shot.
Yeah. Yeah,
wow.
King is really doing a nice job. He's got Brand pushed up against the cage. He's now looking for takedown. He's got it.
He got that double.
Yep, just scooped him right up. His back up against the cage, didn't have anywhere to go. King doing a nice job.
Yeah, this is a bad position for Brand to be in.
Let's go, improve your position. I'm going to stand you up, improve your position. Let go of the fence. Up or down. Fight.
And King is comfortable letting his opponent, Billy Brand, back to his feet.
Brand's landed a nice leg kick. Check there by King. Not really overly active with his hands. Just keeps going to those kicks.
Nice sweep of the leg by King.
Yep.
I mean, Brand, the way that he is positioning himself in this fight, he looks very confident, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like before every exchange, he always looks game. He's going for the arm here. He's trying to soften King up with some of those punches, but King just is every single time that Brand seems to be getting a little bit of a rhythm going, King does something like grab that leg and kick out the other one, and once again ends up in top position.
And another takedown that's getting scored on the judges' scorecards, too.
Yeah, and not a lot of time left in this round. So a minute and 15 seconds left here in round number two. Only three rounds in this fight, and so far, Ian King is just dominating. Now, you see those legs of Brand starting to creep up a little bit.
Yep.
Yeah, he's trying to pull him in. He's trying to control him and also potentially trying to set up a submission. But again, King works right past it with just hard work, just gutting it out.
Yeah, throw some body shots there. He's, you know, not landing a whole lot of damage, but, I mean.
He's staying busy.
Yes.
You know? King coming in. Seems confident to work past the onslaught that's going to come from Billy Brand on his back. And once again, 35 seconds left here in the second round, and this has been all Ian King.
Brand trying to stand up. But at this point, he's going to need something if he wants to take this round.
Yeah, it's going to have to be something significant. He's going to have to knock King down or really threaten him with a potential finish here in these final 20 seconds. Otherwise, you know, King doing a nice job keeping that distance close, keeping Brand pushed up against the cage, neutralize any potential offense.
Nice left there by Brand and a big knee.
Yeah, that knee caught him.
And an uppercut.
Yeah, he's rocked right now, and King doing, again, a great job of. That's the end of round number two. King got rocked hard there. He's actually walking to the wrong corner right now.
Yeah, his nose is split.
Yeah, he is feeling it.
But did a very good job of working out of that and getting another takedown at the end, almost negating all the action that Brand did there. We saw the knee right there on the replay, and we're going to see one of the uppercuts. That's the one I think split open his nose. But we see the takedown here by Brand. Or excuse me, by King right at the end, because Brand just keeps throwing that kick.
He keeps throwing the kick out there, and then he wants to admire his handiwork, so he leaves the leg hanging there. It's something that you see with a lot of guys in training, where they'll throw a kick and they'll sort of be like, I got you, to a training partner, and that's okay. But when you're in a competition like this, especially for the championship in the main event here in Las Vegas, you got to snap those kicks up and snap them right back. Really important to do.
I thought we saw a nice finish there by Brand, but I don't think it was enough. I think Ian King dominated, you know, 45 seconds worth, or you know, all but 45 seconds worth of that fight right there. I have it 2-0 for King going into the third.
Now, I will say that we're watching King right now, who's just right off camera to us, and he does look pretty rough here in between these rounds. He was gasping for a lot of air in between the rounds.
His nose was cracked.
His nose definitely cracked, definitely bleeding from the bridge of that nose. So on to the third and final round. Can King keep this going and close out this fight, or Billy Brand, who looks much fresher, will he be able to finish this off? Crowd really starting to get into this one. Brand, huge right hand! That is the end, a one-punch knockout from Billy Brand. And King looking up at the referee, he's not pleased right now.
That was close.
That was close. So Mark Smith is a great referee. He took a huge shot, though, and when he went down, I'm convinced at minimum that was a flash knockout. Like, he looked out for a moment, but it was so close, and he recovered so quickly.
Yeah.
But you got to keep in mind also that Brand was confident that he had got the knockout there, so he did not jump on him and start to throw a bunch more punches.
And on top of that, there is no need for these fighters to take any extra shots that they don't need to.
Outside leg kick, and bam,
right there. Right on the button.
I think
he covered up quick. It caught him.
I think Mark Smith made the right move there.
If this was the pros, I would say, you know,
if these guys are getting
– you know, like I said, if this was for a championship belt in the UFC, you let it go one more. But for this, and the fighter safety is paramount here in the Tough Enough Fighting Championships. I think that was a good call by Mark Smith. As much as Ian King didn't want that fight to end, I think it's better for him that it did.
Yeah, and that's exactly what Billy Brand needed to do in order to win that fight. Here is the official announcement. Justin Bernard is in the cage right now with a very happy Billy Brand and a disappointed Ian King. All right, one more time. Let's take a look at this. Big right hand directly to the chin. King's mouthpiece went flying out, too.
I didn't see that earlier.
I think he was out. That was the right decision. Here we go. Official announcement.
Presenting the championship belt is Kyle Sanford from Stealthletic Gear. Ladies and gentlemen, after 13 seconds into the third round, your winner by knockout and new Tough Enough Featherweight Champion, Billy Brand.
Billy Brand getting the belt put on. Justin's going to talk to him.
Standing inside here, the cage with the winner, Billy Brand, the new Tuff-N-Uff featherweight champion, as they put the medal on. What a back and forth war between you guys. It looks like it was sweeping you, taking you down. Back and forth, what was the game plan coming in up against Ian King?
Not to give myself a two-round deficit, that's for sure. First round, got him on the ground. I was real scared of his jiu-jitsu, if I'm being honest. I realized once he did take me down that he had a good outside trip double that I wasn't expecting. Once he got me on the ground, though, I didn't feel threatened, you know? So I probably spent way too much time on my back. Ryan's probably going to grill me for wherever he is. But third round, I knew I was down two rounds. Even though I ended the second one strong, I knew I was down. So had to knock him out.
Jake told me that.
Well, it looked like you had great training. You were prepared for anything, and you came out with the win. You want to thank anybody out here tonight?
Yeah, I'm going to need to hold this. It's going to take a minute. Jake, I've been training with him since I was like 12, 13 years old. That dude's really like been a big brother to me. Big Ryan, that dude is killer. Dave, my manager, for setting this up. I sound really stupid. I hear myself on the speaker, so I'm going to shut up now. And thanks to my pops, wherever he is. I know he's tripping right now. All right, love you guys. Thank you.
You're a champion, ladies and gentlemen. Tuff-N-Uff featherweight champ, Billy Brand. We'll see everybody at the D Long Bar. We'll see you out there tonight. The official after party. We'll see you out there. We got replays of tonight's fights all night long at the Long Bar. Right across the street, the D. Thank you to all of our sponsors out here tonight. The ISKA, the Hooters Girls, and of course, the Downtown Las Vegas Event Center. We'll see you. Mayhem in Mesquite. Go to toughenough.com for more information. Have a great weekend. TJ E. Doc.
So there you have it. Barry Myers, world famous Tuff-N-Uff, brings you the future stars of MMA. I loved how honest that Billy Brand was there at the end, where he said, look, I didn't mean to get down two rounds to none. His fight IQ is certainly there. It's been a fantastic night tonight here in Las Vegas. Downtown Las Vegas Event Center turned out to be a beautiful night. And Mahoney, out of all these fights that we saw, we had what, one fight go to the judges' scorecards?
Two
fights go to the judges' scorecards. All of the rest, very quick finishes. That's what Tuff-N-Uff brings, some awesome fights. And beyond that, we've got ourselves some tremendous fighters that compete in Tuff-N-Uff. And so there you have it, a beautiful night of fights with some huge knockouts, some great submissions, some weird things happen like broken fingers and other referee slowdowns at moments, but a great job by the officiating team, a great job by everyone here on the backside with the Tuff-N-Uff production. So great to be alongside you tonight, Mahoney, here in Las Vegas.
One of the best things that you know that you're always going to get from a Tuff-N-Uff fight is that you're going to have an entertaining night of fights, and that's what we did here again in the fight capital of the world, Las Vegas, downtown Las Vegas. Beautiful night. Couldn't have asked for better fights. Whew, worn out.
You know what? And our next stop is going to be in Mesquite the Casablanca in the middle of May, so we're going to have a lot of fun out there. So if those of you that are in the area or you want to make a little road trip, let's go to Mesquite in May.
Fly into Las Vegas. Drive out to Mesquite if you're listening online. It's worth it.
It's going to be a good time. Again, thank you so much for being with us. For Barry Myers, world famous future stars of MMA, we certainly saw some bright shining stars tonight. Billy Brand walking away with that Tuff-N-Uff featherweight championship. From the downtown Las Vegas Event Center in the heart of downtown Las Vegas, it has been great to be with you. I'm Dave Farrell alongside Jason Mahoney. Good night.